first time we met, I knew you'd cause me gray prematurely. April griped while clawing at clumps of her brassy blonde hair and squeezing her golden badge until a star-shaped imprint marked her left palm. But I honestly thought I'd have a better chance at predicting the Pennsylvania state lottery numbers before guessing you'd paint a bullseye on your own forehead for the Castigliano mob family. Seriously, Kellan, you've made a royal mess of this situation. Are they going to take pot shots at me next? We bantered steadfastly in her downtown office at the Wharton County Administrative Building with the door glued shut. Very few people knew what happened to my supposedly dead wife, Francesca. I shrugged and offered my best apology face, which unintentionally resembled a confused puppy in search of a warm place to sleep, rather than a truly sorrowful man who'd never intended to wreak such havoc. We've covered this several times in the last 3 weeks. I should have immediately informed you that Francesca's family faked her death. I didn't know what to do until that last note from Castigliano Vargas confirmed they'd kidnapped her as a revenge tactic to punish the Castellanos. I rested both hands and my chin on the heavily papered desk, grinning widely as if my jaw were about to unhinge and blinked twice through stylish glasses to endear myself to the sheriff. At least she'd stopped calling me Little Airwick. Of all the nicknames I'd heard during my 32 years, that was the most insulting. There was nothing little about me anymore. Upon graduating from Braxton a decade ago, I'd transformed from an awkward middle child in a complex, overachieving family into what many women eagerly deemed a devilishly handsome and well-built guy, blessed with clever wit and a charming personality. Don't get me wrong, I'm not an egomaniac. I've merely settled into myself and accepted the positive and the negative. Lately, there were tons more negative than I cared to tolerate. At least Nana D still called me Brilliant One, which melted my heart every time. That's your apology? April vigorously shook her head and slammed a Tweety Bird coffee mug on the desk's smooth metal surface. Drops of cold, muddy brown liquid splashed across it and landed on my upper lip. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. She whined repentantly, while handing me a napkin from a squeaky drawer. Oh, and in case you forgot, that's how you ask for forgiveness. Had it not been for the tiniest of curls at the sides of her sarcastic mouth, I wouldn't have known April was teasing me. We'd spent an inordinate amount of time joined at the hip, organizing everything that had happened in the last 2.5 years since the accident. Okay, backstory time. Francesca and I had arrived separately at a Thanksgiving party because I'd been working out of town earlier in the week. Our daughter, Emma, begged to ride home with me, a monumental blessing in disguise, rather than her mother. Little did I know at the time, Francesca's parents, Vincenzo and Cecilia Castigliano, had orchestrated the entire facade. When I received the call that my wife had been struck and killed by a drunk driver, I did my best to rally with the help of Nana D, my 5-foot-tall Spitfire grandmother. Meanwhile, Francesca lived covertly in the Castigliano mansion until her parents could divine a way to resolve the turf war with Las Vargas, the rival mafia family controlling much of the West Coast. 2 years had zipped by without a viable solution or anyone learning their secret. A few months ago, Em and I moved back home to Braxton, the small town in north-central Pennsylvania where I'd been raised and now worked as an assistant professor specializing in communications and film studies. Francesca chose that moment to materialize from hiding, jealous and angry about the sudden inability to watch her daughter grow up in L.A. After I refused to hibernate in captivity, she took off, letting her parents and me think that she was visiting all the places we'd once vacationed in, a blissful trip down memory lane. At some point, Castigliano Vargas had discovered Francesca was alive, captured my not-so-dead wife and forced her to mail postcards from every location to dangle us in a state of confusion.